And
that's on.
Who's representing Magnus Cole here? Okay, come on, my sister's done. So one, two, three, and just spend a few minutes and explain what this giving us a recommendation.
She may not be able to
move forward, but we're very able to do it. Thank you. Secretary of Hi. Basically, we talked about, it was more specifically about these Chester Gardens complex. One of the things that we're working, that tenants are made to approach the police for fear of retaliation from the people who may be committing the offenses. We talked about the need to bring back personal control.
Yes.
And also an increase in the foot control here. We have, we know that there are meeting every Tuesday, tenants meeting, and it would be helpful if the police would attend all the meetings as well. So that's basically what we talked about, was more specific to the East Chester Gardens community. And there were a lot of good recommendations. So we talked about the body cams would benefit both the police officer and the people, community at large. So if anything happens, you know, we have a recorded record of the action.
Or Nassau County, or New Jersey, or Suffolk County, where it's completely different.
different than what our communities look like and what we experience. Their experience in the suburb is completely different from our experience now here in the city. The big emphasis for our group was training. And we talked about a couple of things. First and foremost, training to address them, being compassionate and having a better understanding of the people that they work with, cultural diversities and knowing the differences, how to deal with different cultural groups, how to deal with people that may have mental health challenges. Also, we talked about having them to get a better understanding of the community that they work in and patrolling the area that they are assigned to. Also making a consideration with regards to where the police are posted. When they get assigned, they may not be able to handle going to the projects depending on where they come from. And just because a person is African American or a person of color, that does not mean that they can handle being in the projects. There's some of us that may not live there. I live in a tenement building and I don't know if I can navigate going into the project, and I believe that some of the officers may feel the same way as well. The last thing that we said that might be a reach is if they do get psychological evaluations before they are assigned as police officers, that they should have that every 6 months. They should be evaluated, because just like you deal with people in the community that have mental health issues or they may have PTSD, police officers, I believe, also go through the same thing, depending on where they come from. And if they have been assigned to a very challenging area, they can be biased by someone that actually worked in the community at one point and said, look out for this block over here because this is what goes on. So before they even go into the community to meet the people, they're already going in with a certain skew and a certain bias. So those are the things that we came up with, and I thought that this was absolutely wonderful. Last thing is that we need to take a look at the areas where the actual stop and frisk has been successful and has been applied appropriately, and see how it worked in those areas. And those are the areas that should be used as models, so that the other areas where it has not worked well or where it's been applied the wrong way can be trained by those officers. Thank you.
Just to remember, you know, as we deal with this issue and as we're going to continue to deal with issues around criminal justice, also let's also wrap our head around what we can do as community ourselves to improve relations on from our side to their side. How do we, because I'm a believer that we can be, neighbor can be restored back into the hood, and that the village can once again raise its children. And I think when we start thinking intentionally around those measures, you know, what can we do internally to create the safe community that we all desire? And some of you know that one of the things that that we were able to do here is that, you know, we were able to get some reduction in gun violence, etc. But we've got a long way to go, right? But it's going to take us working together, not just coming together today, but making this not just a project, but a lifelong goal, so that we can preserve our generations that are coming up behind us. So once again, give yourselves a hand, give our monitors a hand. I'm going to turn it over to Judge Berlin for final comments. And again, my name is Reverend Q English. I'm the president of the Bronx Clergy Criminal Justice Roundtable. I'm also the co-founder of the People's Police Academy, as well as the co-founder of the New York City Clergy Roundtable. And my husband and I, we pastor, Pastor Tim English, raise your hands. Bronx Christian Fellowship, right there on Gun Hill Road between Paulding and Laconia. We're a believer of being a church without walls. You know, and it's all about what's happening in our community that really makes us church. And so, and without further ado, I'm going to ask Judge Berlin to come up and give us final comments, and then we're going to have a grace over the food, and then we're going to eat.
Thank you very much, Reverend. So I really want to answer any questions, but I do want to point out a couple of things because I went from one group to the other listening. A big concern is how police approach people when they, you know, think they, even if they think they have reasonable suspicion to believe someone's committed a crime. And I just wanted, I didn't say this to the group, what, do you have an understanding what is reasonable suspicion? Maybe I did say this, is somebody going in the parking lot with a parked car trying to break in. If I did say that before, those are examples, okay? But that's not what we're dealing with, clearly. I wouldn't be here if the cops had acted according to that standard. One of the things people did say was the police ought to learn how to treat the people they approach in any circumstance respectfully. So, I just want to share with you that if you go to the website, you'll see that the police are actually being trained, every single new recruit, in respectful policing, in procedural justice, in implicit bias, and also in de-escalation. Because sometimes instead of making a situation good, they make it far worse by the way they conduct themselves. So all the police are being trained that way. Last thoughts I want to leave you with is there's 35,000 police officers in New York City. And they have, as you probably understand, a very, very difficult job. And they've been doing this kind of work, some of them, under this type of policy for a long time. So they have to be retrained, they have to be held accountable, right, for violations. They have to develop a new sort of thinking. And these things the monitor is doing, they take time when you have that many people to deal with. I'm not excusing them, I'm not here to represent them, I'm just sharing that if you think of that, it's going to take a while to unwind and change that department. I do believe that at the highest levels, they really are committed to some of these changes, but just want to put that out to you, that so that, you know, the situation might look hopeless, and I don't think it is. However, like Reverend Hugh says, you know, this can't stop here because police, like any city agency, like any government agency, responds to the public, right? That's why I'm even here, is because there's a lot of protests and organizing. So, you know, if you're into this, if you think it should be followed, you have to act on it. Anyways, I'm the only thing keeping you from lunch. I want to keep talking. If there's anything, any questions out here for anyone? Right. Well, thank you very, very much for coming out today, and thanks to Reverend.